Welcome back to the Conquest Champions League Season 3. In this game, we have Jeremy, the Green Dragon, the winner of Season 1, playing his Army of Lake Town, going up against Marcus, the Terror from the East, leading his Easterlings. The winner of this game will advance into the semi-finals, and the loser will be eliminated. In the Conquest Champions League, I've taken 8 tournament veterans and pitted them against each other in an elimination-style tournament. In Game 1, we saw a clash of giants with Sean playing as Rangers going up against Alex with the Haradrim. Game 2 saw PJ with the Army of the Dead going up against Nathan with his Isengard. Game 3 was David playing as Mordor versus Tyler with the Last Alliance. If you haven't seen those episodes yet, check out this playlist in the top corner. And if you want to see all the army lists, you can follow the link in the description. I asked you, the audience, who you thought was going to win, and Jeremy is a favorite going into this game. Let's meet our players and see their armies.
I'm Jeremy, and I'm playing my Army of Lake Town with some Elven allies against Marcus's Easterlings. It's based around Bard's family with his kids, and then the Master with Alfred and Braga, who are going to cause some problems with that because they've got some interactions that don't agree with each other. And then I've got Legolas and Tauriel as well, and a bunch of the Lake Town Guard.
Hi, I'm Marcus, and this is my first time on the Conquest Champions League. Today I'm playing Easterlings. My army for the Conquest Champions League is I've got Rutabi leading as my general. She's leading a full warband with banner, drum, 12 warriors with a mix of spears, pikes, and some of them been upgraded to black dragons. I've then got Emder. He's got 2 black dragon cataphracts with him and 4 archers. He's my real, like, heavy hitter. And then I've got a captain on horse rounding it out with some archers, a black dragon acolyte, and some more warriors with spears, shields, pikes, and some black dragons there as well.
Today's scenario is Storm the Camp, one of the least popular scenarios in the players pack, but we're going to give it a run today. Each player has a camp, which is their deployment zone, that is 12 inches from the corner of the board. The objective is to kill the enemy leader, break the enemy, and importantly, have more models in your opponent's camp than they do. This should be a really interesting one that's going to leverage shooting and maneuverability. This episode of the Conquest Champions League is brought to you by Epic Basing. Epic Basing make a variety of bits to go on your miniatures bases, and they have a huge range. I've got their cactuses on my Farharad bases, Alex has their mushrooms on his Dwarven bases, and PJ has a variety of their bushes on his Bjornings and Radagast bases. These bits are ultra detailed, and you can either get them as a physical product or as STL files that you can 3D print yourself at home. The first 75 people to use the code EPICCONQUEST can get a discount on their order, and that'll let them know that you guys were coming from this video. Supporting our sponsors supports us, so please check out Epic Basing. Alright, let's get back to the video.
This is going to be a tough matchup for me. My plan is to shoot the army down, but the defense of Marcus's army is really concerning for me, so I might be able to get a chip wound or two there, but I think it's going to come down to combat, and that's where I've got my 3 heroes' strength. So they're going to have to go and use all their heroic actions. I've got a lot of might in my army to try and take down key targets, and then just hope that they can sweep up the rest of them with the help of the Lake Town Guard. So it's going to be a challenging matchup, so a little bit nervous about this one, but if I stick to my plan, I should be able to make a good game of it.
And it looks like I'm playing the Army of Lake Town, which I feel optimistic about. It feels like a pretty good matchup. Lots of small heroes there, so I'm really hoping Emder has a good day. He can get some kills and get some might back and get some more kills and get some might back. That's going to be a good day for him. They've got some high fight heroes, so hopefully the Phalanx stands up to that. And yeah, let my characters do work.
I'm going to have a go at giving some dubious counsel to Bard from Alfred before we get the priority underway. So I'm going to spend a point of will. I can spend any number. So I spend one, I roll on a 2+. Bard's getting an extra point of will. And he is. Oh, not will, might. So Bard is up to 4. Okay, I'm going to move Bard half speed here just to make sure he can get a shot off. So the elves I'm going to send forward just 3 inches to make sure they can use their bows.
So I see that Jeremy's put the majority of his heroes, including the kids, up in the top of the board here. So that's where I want to get Emder over to, because they represent free might. I also have to avoid exposing myself to too many shots. I'm definitely going to get shot, but just want to try to minimize it.
And Marcus climbed up on top of the Orcish barracks, giving him a good vantage point for if the army of Lake Town start attacking his camp, he'll be able to shoot at them as they approach.
And here we are in the shooting phase. Jeremy, what's happening?
Okay, I've got my Lake Town guard. I'm going to have a go at this horde of Easterlings here with an in the way for the wall. They all move, so a 5 will get a hit. And I need to go through the wall at a 4+. No good. Okay, so now I'm going to take the two elves at Rutabi. They both can see Rutabi, but it's going to be a tough shot. So Tariel's the green. Tariel's going to go through the wall. And Legolas is going to use the one shot for the 2+ to try and hit. So at Rutabi, Legolas has hit.
Tariel's missed.
Tariel has missed. And defense for Rutabi?
7.
So I need a 6.
Got it. Ooh, got a 6. That's no good.
Will you be using fate because she's your leader?
Yeah, I will. I'll pop a fate. She's got 2 fates, so I'll go for 1. That's good.
Sounds good. First shot with the Bard at Amduel with lots of in the ways. Has hit. First in the way, gets through the spikes. Second in the way on the animal, gets through. Does it go up or down on Amduel? It goes up. Defense
6.
Yep, takes a wound.
Takes a wound.
And that was the first shot.
I'll take the wound on Amduel.
Okay, second shot because I hit the first one. Yes, all good. Through the first thing, yes. Through the horse, yes. So it's on Amduel again. Up or down? It is down. Oh. What's the defense of the horse?
6.
So needing a 5. Yep, take the horse off.
Brutal.
Thrown rider.
Yep.
He's fine.
Okay, and the last shot, I can't see Amduel anymore because he's fallen behind the horse, so I will just go for that rider over here. Misses on the last shot. What a shame.
Where was that when the first shot came?
Nowhere to be seen.
Turn 3 priority went to Jeremy, and Marcus declared that he was drumming. Jeremy's just starting up by moving all of his archers half so they can keep advancing forward slightly while still shooting. That does mean that he's kind of giving up on attacking Marcus's camp in this early game, so it'll be interesting to see if he starts sending guys full speed later on in the game. That goes into Marcus's move.
Even though Amduel lost his horse though, Rutabi and a phalanx are still pretty strong, so they're going to come straight through the middle and look to close the gap as quickly as we can.
Marcus has some archers up in this terrain piece that are going to be firing at any of Jeremy's models that attack the camp.
Amduel losing his horse is pretty significant, so those guys who are going to run the flank might have to back off a bit now.
Shooting this turn was a lot less eventful, with only one Easterling dying. Because they moved, a lot of these archers ended up missing. Marcus had some Easterling archers on the flank that shot, but didn't do anything.
Priority has just gone to Lake Town, but Marcus, what's happening?
I'm drumming with my drummer, and my captain's calling a march, so those infantry are going to have a 12-inch movement this turn.
That's huge.
Now, Jeremy knows that Marcus is coming in hot and fast here, so he decided to move some of his archers up full. I'm expecting they're going to start running around the side, hopefully making a play for the long game, and he's just advancing the rest of his lines. Knowing he can't be charged this turn, he's got a little bit more freedom, but he knows that next turn, the fighting will begin.
So the aim here is to be able to charge everything next turn. Sick of getting shot. So we're going to get right up and close to Jeremy. We're going to move some guys so they're just an inch away. And just deal with the shooting this turn, knowing that we're not going to get a shot again after this.
And the shooting phase started off with Legolas taking 3 shots at Amduel, getting a single hit, but inflicting a wound, which is massive. Amduel's got 1 wound and 1 fate remaining. And after that, 3 Lake Town archers had a shot at this captain, rolling very well. They inflicted a wound.
Shooting this game has been brutal, with the Lake Town archers killing another Easterling. That goes to next turn.
That takes us into the next turn. Before priorities roll, Jeremy, what are you doing?
I'm going to try to give another point of might to Bard.
All right, so Alfred's dubious counsel.
He gives it to him.
6, he does give him a point of might. So Bard's up to 5 might now?
Correct.
Scary. And that goes to the roll for priority. This seems like it's going to be a pretty big one.
4. Goes right to me.
Goes to the Easterlings. Is there any heroics to declare?
There certainly is. I will do a heroic move with... who's in a good spot for it? It's going to be Bard.
So Rutabi's got Master of Battle. On a 3+, she can copy Bard's heroic move if she's within 6. So we'll go for the copy. Doesn't copy. I'm going to spend a real might on Rutabi
sure
to call her own move.
Here's the big roll off. 1, 2, 3 goes Easterlings.
Goes to good.
Nice.
Goes to the good side on a 6. So Bard charging Rutabi.
Yep.
Leader on leader fight there.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good to me.
The next model that Jeremy went with was Legolas, who went wide around that control zone and also into Rutabi. This took a little bit of finagling with some control zones, but Jeremy managed to pull it off. That means it's Bard and Legolas fighting Rutabi at this stage, which has got to be pretty scary for Marcus. Into Marcus's move, he just shimmied around his pikes to make sure they were in the right position to be able to support the heroes that he needed them to, and these two cataphracts charged into the Lake Town Guard, meaning he should be attacking the camp. In Marcus's shooting phase, he actually managed to get 2 kills this turn, and Jeremy didn't get any.
And here we are at the start of the combat phase. Jeremy, what do you have to declare first?
Okay, so I'm going to do the money bags with the Master of Lake Town to give everyone within 6 inches that's a Lake Town model, 1+5 and a banner roll. And I'm going to do 3 heroic combats with both Bane and with Bard as well.
All right.
In response to that, I'm going to strike up with Amdur against Tariel.
Mm-hmm. And Tariel will take the strike as well.
Rutabi's going to try to copy that strike. She doesn't, so she's going to have to copy, she's going to have to use her own might to call her own strike in combat against Bard and Legolas.
Yeah, otherwise so I wouldn't do it because we're already the same fight. So yeah. Okay, yeah. And because of that, I'll spend Legolas' point of might to do a strike as well.
And lastly, my captain is going to call a heroic combat over there on the flank.
Mm.
And first fight is the captain, Eastland captain's heroic combat. Let's see the rolls. They're both 5-4.
And flanking.
5-3.
Okay, I'm going to take my banner reroll. Yep.
I've got it. That'll do it.
He is very dead. Where's that captain going?
Captain is going to go first and get this guy.
Sure.
That's the question. My base may not actually fit in there.
No.
Which case?
Okay,
fine.
Easy.
Yeah, easy. Move up into there and just
stay out of that one.
Just get that guy there.
Sure. Yeah, makes sense. That makes heaps sense.
Yep.
So the next fight is Rutabi fighting Bard, Legolas, and a Lake Town guard. They both struck. Let's see the strikes.
8.
Ooh. 10.
All right.
You got the higher fight. I'll roll my 6 to set the bar with a 6.
Also a 6.
You all win. Right. I am trapped.
Mm-hmm. Well, 3 might off Bard and 2 might off Legolas to flash kill Rutabi.
Yep. So Legolas is out of might now and Bard has only got 1.
That was an absolutely huge play from Jeremy. He had to call that heroic combat to make sure that Rutabi was trapped against the other combats next to her. It's going to be interesting to see if Marcus can pull it back from losing his leader like that. And that went into the rest of the fights, where Bane did have a free heroic combat because he is close to the daughters. He did manage to kill his opponent, which was quite lucky because he's only 1 attack, and then he just repositioned further away from the battle line. Now, in these battle lines, Jeremy's warriors are only defense 4, so they should be getting rinsed. The Eastland captain managed to get another kill, and a couple more Lake Town guard went down. But then in the second half, Legolas did well, getting another kill for himself. And then in this big clash of lines where there was a lot of Lake Town guard and a lot of Eastlings with pikes, the Lake Town guard just outperformed the Eastlings, which was really surprising because they rolled a lot better than I think they should have in there.
Into the final fight, Amdur and Tariel are both fight 10 in here. They both have Elven Blades. Let's see it.
Why not?
I'm on the 6.
Ooh.
Certainly are. I'll take the reroll. Ooh. Yeah, you win it.
I win.
All right.
So Tariel's got 2 wounded, 3 fate. And I'll be wounding her on. She's defense 5, so 5's to wound both ways.
Yep.
1 wound, I have no rerolls or anything, so just the 1 wound on Tariel.
I'll just take it.
The turn finished off with Marcus's Cav doing well against these 2 Lake Town Guard, killing one of them and knocking the other prone. These guys are going for the objective.
And priority has been rolled and gone to Lake Town. Marcus, any heroics here?
I mean, there's the only one left. He's actually in a fine spot, I think. I'm just going to have to take the charges this turn.
It's the right call, actually.
Yeah. So, come fight me.
Yeah.
After last turn where 12 points of might has spent, this has gone a little bit different with no heroics, which makes sense because both of them are now running out of might. Importantly, Bard and Bane both charge the Easterling Captain, and then the rest of the Lake Town Guard just pushed forwards. Now, this is going to be scary for Jeremy because the Easterlings just have more attacks than them in these fights.
So he's going down. He's going to climb down the ladder. And then just move that way a little bit. And then these guys are actually going to come down the inside ladder and pop out. Some of them will start popping out this door. Popping out that door. That's their full move.
Marcus finished his move by just pushing up his other archers around the flank and then just addressing the lines, making sure his pikes are in the right places to maximize his chance of winning fights and getting kills.
Here we are at the start of the combat phase. What is happening, guys?
So the master has once again used the last of his money to try and bribe all the Lake Town, and Bragger got excited about that. So it's called a heroic combat, as well as Bane and Bard together in the same combat. Bane called a combat against the captain. So I'm hoping to do some serious damage to that captain this turn and then turn my attention to Amdur.
And just confirming, Bane gets that for free because Sigurd and Tilda are within 6 inches.
Correct, within 6 inches of both of them. So he gets 1+ fight for one of them. And if he's even 2, he gets 1+ fight and gets a free heroic combat.
And starting with Braga's heroic combat, let's see the rolls.
3, 4. I've got a banner.
Mm-hmm.
2 or 3, you'll win.
Sounds good.
This guy will back away to there, and then this guy can back away.
So defense is 6. So the reds will be 5s. I'll use a point of might.
Yep.
So there's the 7th dead Easterling coming out there.
Mm-hmm.
And where's Braga going?
Braga is going to go into this one here. And this one here is just going to go and slide forward into that one.
Fight is the Easterling captain fighting Bane and Bard.
Yep.
Let's see it.
3, 5. Cool. I'll take my banner. 2 or 5. You
don't
will
mark.
Win.
Because you don't have your mark.
6s.
Nope. And I'll go Bane's one at the horse. No.
That's a great result.
The next fight also went well for Marcus, where he won the fight against Braga and inflicted a wound to him after he failed his fate. And the next fight went from bad to worse for Jeremy, where Legolas also lost his fight and also copped a wound. Now across the rest of these fights, a couple more Lake Town guard were slain, and importantly, none of the Easterlings went down. So it's a big difference from last turn, and they're starting to see the value of those pikes and the high defense. These two cav killed the guy on the flank.
And the final one is Amdur fighting Tariel. Let's see it.
Yep, let's do it.
I'm on the 6. You're on the 6 with the same fight.
So I've got the roll off.
Roll off and...
Both have Elven Blades, so 1, 2, 3 goes Easterlings, 4, 5, 6 goes Elves.
Easterlings.
There's the Easterlings. Alright.
Nothing.
Ooh.
4s don't even do it. Yeah, that is unfortunate. We'll go.
At the end of the turn, Lake Town has lost 9 models, but they've lost a wound on Legolas, Tariel, and Braga. While the Easterlings have lost 7 models, one of them is Rutabi, and Amdur has, is it 1 wound, 1 fate left?
1 wound, 1 fate.
All right, so interesting spot in the game. Let's get into the next turn. Behind the scenes, Jacob here, and we have a ton of fun stuff going on. If you like these videos and you want to see more like them, then consider jumping on the Kingdom of Tor Ithilas Kickstarter waiting page, where we're going to release that next wave of terrain. Let's get back to the game.
And we're into turn 7, where priority once again went to Jeremy, and he's starting by charging Bard into that Easterling captain, hoping to do a bit more damage this turn. And then Braga and the rest of the Lake Town are just adjusting in those lines, trying to hold back that line of Easterlings because they are pushing towards the camp. Now Jeremy did send one model up here into this building, so he could go down the other side to start attacking the camp.
Tariel's going to jump into this one and wrap around.
Ooh.
Into those two.
Mm-hmm.
Is she running away from Amdur there, Jeremy?
Yeah, she needs to whittle down the numbers a little bit. So then this one is just going to go charge Amdur.
And into Marcus's move, he's just running full speed with these archers. If they can cross the board and get to the camp, that will win Marcus the game. And it doesn't seem like they need to do much shooting. These are the archers that stayed in the backfield. Originally, they were going to defend the camp, but Jeremy's attacks are so far off that it's worth running forwards. And finally, Marcus moved his cavalry forwards. They're just staying 6 inches away from the Lake Town Guard in the back, so next turn they can either go for the camp or go in and try to help their soldiers in the line. And the fighting is going to start out with the captain fighting against Bard, who's called a free heroic combat.
5.
I've got a 5
You've
as well.
You've got a 5. I'll take my banner.
Yep.
Not a 6. You've got the win.
Yep. Red at the rider.
Rider. That'll do it. He's only got the 1 word left. Because you...
Oh, yeah, of course. Earlier. Yeah, okay. So that will do it, and that gets the heroic combat off. Okay. 2, and then 4 to wrap around here. Just make sure it can't go anywhere backwards.
Yep.
And then this one's just going to go on the top here.
Yep, he's trapped.
To do that, yep.
And the next fight to go was just down the line, where Amdur unsurprisingly managed to chop his way through one of the army of Lake Town. Now, the important thing is that the Lake Town army is actually quite low model count because there's so many heroes, and Jeremy is slowly starting to run out of numbers. The defense four is catching up with him as these warriors are just dropping like flies against the much stronger defense six Easterlings. That being said, he is still winning some fights and getting some kills on some of the trapped opponents. That goes into the next turn. And priority this turn went to Jeremy once again with the elves and the army of Lake Town, and he's managed to tie up a lot of these Easterlings. Importantly, it's in a way that Amdur is blocked out of combat by his own soldiers. And he went forwards with the daughters. I'm not really sure what he's thinking here. He needs to keep them safe. I get at this point he's got them back within 6 inches of Bard, but he's not fighting over there, so it seems like some exposure. This Lake Town just moved to the top of that staircase, and then the Easterling cavalry moved in their movement, charging into their enemies, hoping to get some kills and just break through Jeremy's line, and then Marcus can just walk in, storm the camp, which is the objective, of course. In the line, Amdur wasn't able to fight because all his own soldiers were in the way, so he just moved around to get his banner effect to support everyone. That went into the shooting phase, where Bard, who had stayed still, did not get a single kill, and then these Easterlings are firing back.
So in the Easterling shooting phase, these three archers, I thought they were going to go for Bard, but just behind him is his daughter Sigrid. They kill Sigrid, Bard will go insane and do everything he can to kill him.
I want to do this one at the back first. He hits.
Mm-hmm.
4 strength defense.
Defense is... Defense 2.
So she's been wounded.
Lower defense. First fate, second fate, and gone.
So dead. Sigrid
so
has
this,
just been...
This away. Archer just killed Sigrid.
Yeah, so we've got to remember that is because Bard's going to chase.
Sigrid. Yeah, the back one.
Yeah.
The other two front ones are going to shoot at Bard.
Yeah.
One hit, and another wound.
Yep, cool.
And when one of Bard's daughters is slain, he must do everything he can in his power to go and kill the model that killed his daughter. After he's killed that model, he then must charge the nearest, closest enemy model for the rest of the game. So that is a big deal for Bard. He's going to be chasing after those archers. That takes us into the combat phase. Jeremy, what have you declared?
Heroic combat with Tauriel. I have to have another shot at Amdur and try and finish this game off. And also a heroic defense with Braga, which ended up being free because the Master of the Lake Town was in 6 inches and he passed his 4+.
Nice. And Marcus, you have no heroes in combat?
No.
Just sitting there?
Amdur got held out, so yeah.
That's Tutorial.
Tutorial.
Go with the ninja first. And then she's going to charge Amdur and wrap around.
Oh, okay. Ooh.
You will get 6.
And a 5 and 2.
Yep.
And as the battles raged, things didn't go particularly well for the army of Lake Town. Their defense 4, as I've been saying all battle report, is catching up with them as they go down pretty quickly, and the high defense Easterlings are able to survive. The Easterlings still did take some casualties, but they're definitely outpacing the killing power of the Lake Town warriors.
Our final fight of the turn is Tauriel fighting Amdur and a friend. They're both fight 6. Tauriel's got 4 attacks, Amdur's got 3 and a friend, so it's 4 dice versus 4 dice.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see it.
Let's do it. 6.
5 to me, so I'll take a banner roll with Amdur.
Mm-hmm.
And I will spend a point of Amdur's might to get the 6.
Sure.
So he's got 1 left now.
Yep. And the roll off.
Here's the roll off.
And it's good.
It's good.
So Tauriel is going to, you've got 1 wound and 1 fate.
1 wound and 1 fate and 1 might.
They're the same defense to kill, isn't it?
They're both defense 6, yeah.
Yep, so I'm just going to attack Amdur, but after the second wound, it'll bounce the other one.
Yep.
So 5 to wound. That's one wound. I will spend my last point of might to kill him.
And I can't, even if I pass the fate, I am dead.
Yeah.
So Amdur finally taken down. And that is no heroes left on the Easterling side.
Correct.
And here we are at the end of that turn. That was a huge turn all round. So 4 Lake Town Guard went down, meaning, Jeremy, are you one off break?
I am one off break, yeah.
Fantastic. And you lost Amdur, Marcus. How far off break are you?
I've got 3 off from breaking.
All right. And this scenario ends on quarter. So there's a chance that, Easterlings are threatening that camp, which could get them the win. But if the Lake Town keep fighting and they hold the camp and they don't lose their leader, which is Bard, they'll win. So interesting spot in the game. It's nice and tight. That goes into the next turn.
Priority once again went to Jeremy with the Army of Lake Town, and he's just using this movement to engage models all around the battlefield, trying to get favorable matchups, and Tariel going into two models to of course get her extra attack in there, and he's having just to send everything in with Bane going in, but Legolas staying still, and the Master still staying in the back. Bard had to charge, which is devastating, meaning he's leaving the battle line behind to kill that archer.
So he's going to move right around. He's going to go get out of Legolas' line of sight and hang out here. So there should be no sight. He's actually just going to move half, but go this way. So that if you heroic.
Sure.
So this guy's going to come around over here.
Yep. Going for the camp.
Going for the camp. Let's get the banner in on this guy. This guy is just going to go in on this guy as well, so I'm going to 2-on-1 there.
And in the shooting phase, Legolas fired everything at this one Easterling archer, but failed to get the wound, so Bard will have to go after him next.
And in the combat phase now, any heroics to declare?
Heroic combat with Bard to try and chase down the archer that...
Go avenge his daughter.
Yeah, avenge! Avenge!
This archer just won his fight against Bard and managed to do a wound. This is the first fate. Second phase passed, so Bard is still unwounded.
And then into the combats, it started off with Jeremy losing two warriors in quick succession.
So I've just lost two models, which has taken me to break, so I have to try and reduce the Easterlings down another three models to even up the break score.
And unfortunately for Jeremy, across the rest of the raging battle, he only managed to get one more kill, and that was with Tariel, meaning Jeremy is broken and Marcus is not.
And at the start of the next turn, Priority went to Lake Town. Easterlings are two models off breaking, and Lake Town is broken.
Mm.
So Jeremy, that goes into your move.
I'm going to try to get to this guy. I can't see him. I'm going to get into this control zone and wrap around as far as I can, so as close as possible to get to there. Then I will start taking some courage tests over here.
And courage tests went decently well for Jeremy. He passed with Bard, Tariel, and then with Braga. And Braga's courage isn't fantastic, so that's really, really nice for him. Braga then went down to charge the cavalry that could be threatening the camp, but after that, disaster struck and the Master of Lake Town fled the battlefield. Because of the standfast, all the warriors managed to stay around, but Jeremy really is running out of warriors, meaning it's just those hardened heroes there to do the work that they need to do to get those kills. That went into Marcus's movement where most things were tied up.
So Marcus, what's the plan with these archers as you're moving them?
Well, these last couple of archers might be able to take some pot shots at Alfred, who's defending the camp in the next couple of turns. So that's the only thinking there. Bard's got to chase this guy down. I think at this point in the game, we're quite close to finishing. A couple of turns to go maybe. So Bard might get him, might not. He's done his job.
And with no shooting, that went into the combat phase. And Jeremy needs to kill Easterlings if he wants to break Marcus. It started out slow, but it did turn around with him managing to kill a knight, and then throughout the rest of the combats managed to get a couple more kills with Tariel doing two herself, meaning that the Easterlings have been broken. And that is absolutely massive because it means that they will need to storm the camp to get a win or kill Bard for a draw.
And at the start of the turn, Priority went to the Easterlings. Jeremy, what have you done?
I'm calling a heroic move with Bane here, just to make sure I can engage as many Easterlings and stop them from getting towards that camp.
All right, let's see his courage test.
Courage of 6. Roll of 6, courage of 4. He's all good.
He's all good.
Ooh. So he's going to move into this one here. So he calls the with me, he started over here, he got, what did he get up to, just these ones here, was it?
Yeah.
And after that heroic move, Marcus still has some guys unengaged, and Jeremy's just trying to get models back towards the camp, including Legolas just running back as fast as he can. Marcus, what's happening here?
I've got a bunch of courage tests to take on all my Eastlings, so +1 courage, let's see how they go.
Yeah, +1 courage for being broken.
And go first on the Cataphract, courage 5, he sticks around, he's going to go and charge this guy here.
Sure.
He sticks around. He's going to go and get in on this guy.
Yep.
This guy here, take his courage check. He's all good. Yep. He's going to get around on Braga. Yep. He's got a 6-inch move on this guy here. Just trying to get to the camp.
Yep.
Everyone there is engaged, so it's going to be this archer here. He's just sticking
just
around.
Good. Just good. Bonus. Mm-hmm. That's two that the other bonus is saved.
And that goes into Jeremy's move where Bard has to move as close as possible to the model that killed his daughter, giving them both an opportunity to shoot him, which they did, but unfortunately neither of them managed to get a wound on Bard. That goes to the combat phase where Jeremy knows that he has the lead and he wants this game to end, so he was using the stab special strike as often as possible to try to rush the end. If the game finished now, he wins. The longer it goes, the more likely Marx is to get into his camp.
Here we are, priority has gone to Easterlings. This could be the last turn of the game. Every single Easterling will need to take a courage test because there's no stand fast. This guy's huge. This cataphract, because he can get into the camp. Let's see it.
Hey. He's sticking around.
Passed.
And he'll have a he should be able to get to Alfred. Yep.
Alright, so charging into Alfred.
Charge. This archer, I think, can also get into the camp, but he won't be able to. Well, it's going to require other people to do work, so archer to move. He passes.
Thanks to the army bonus.
So, 18 inches.
We measured this really carefully. In Storm the Camp, you have to be wholly within the enemy camp, and this model had 90% of its base inside the camp, but was not able to be wholly within. And that is devastating for Marcus. He only has one model in that's fighting against Alfred, and the Bannerman is still running there just in case the game can go for one more turn, but with this bad courage, it's looking pretty unlikely. He doesn't want the Lake Town Guard to flee with their courage too, because that could end the game, so he's trying to tie them up as much as possible.
Yep. And in Jeremy's move, starting out with Legolas, who can make it into the camp.
That's 2 inches, and then he's just gonna go another 4 inches as far as he can this way.
Jeremy finished up by passing his courage check with Braga and just engaging more Easterlings because he wants to kill them. He wants the game to end because currently he's in the lead. In the fight phase, Tariel lost a fight, Bane lost a fight, and then the Easterlings fought against the Lake Town Guard and took a casualty, which is absolutely massive. Bard also killed his opponent, and then this charging Easterling killed Alfred to quarter Lake Town.
With that, the game is over with both sides being reduced to a quarter in the same turn. Now, looking at points, Lake Town, you have points for killing the enemy leader. That's 3 points, and 1 point for breaking the enemy. The Easterlings have 1 point for breaking the enemy, and unfortunately, this archer is half an inch out of being entirely within the enemy camp, and because of that, it's going to be a win to Lake Town, 4-1.
What a game. That army of Lake Town did everything I wanted them to do, except kill in the middle of the game. But that was fine. Marx played a great game. He had me under pressure the whole time, but I managed to get those early wounds for the shooting, which paid off in the end. And I just had enough guys to prevent the camp being run into. It was an amazing game.
Oh, what a game. Half an inch and that archer would have been in there and we would have had the camp. Really glad we got to play Storm the Camp. Excellent game. Really didn't get much out of my heroes, but the Phalanx killed a lot of guys and that archer shooting out secret, definite highlight.
This has been Conquest Creations. Thank you for watching and please stay tuned for the next game in the Conquest Champions League.